informal version. I'm Tom Zinnen. I work here at the Biotech Center. I also work for UW Extension Cooperative Extension. Thanks for coming tonight. We do this every Wednesday night, 50 times a year. Yay. Tonight's a really special night for me. I'm glad to see such a good crowd. I've had a thing for books for a long time. And I worked at the Dixon Public Library when I was in high school, and that just made it worser. We're going to start with Sarah, because I think you're going to lead off. Is that correct, Joshua?
We're going to tag team.
Oh, God, I love tag team. Especially when they hit the canvas and they can't get up.
Don't worry, it's all going to be on video.
So tonight we get to have Holding History, the Nature of the Book. And I'll start with Sarah. Sarah Marty was born in Monroe, Wisconsin. She grew up in Monticello, Wisconsin. And went to Monticello High School because it's not Monticello, which is the instrument. She came here to UW-Madison and got an undergraduate degree in music ed. She was also part of the rowing team. And she has two master's degrees, one in curriculum and instruction, and the other is master's of arts business administration from the Bolt Center. So I don't know if we've ever had anybody from Monticello before, so this is good. Joshua Calhoun is assistant professor in the English department. He was born in Marietta, Georgia, and get this, grew up in Scroon Lake, New York. And he tells me it's not spelled like it sounds. he went to Summit University in Clark Summit, Pennsylvania, and he has a bachelor's of science degree in Bible.
That's
not a combination we've had before. Then he went to the University of Delaware and got his PhD in English and was studying ecology, which is part of what we'll be talking about tonight. So those are our two speakers, and whoever's going to start off, and anyway, let's welcome Joshua and Sarah to Wednesday Night at the Lab.
So good evening, everybody. Oh gosh, I need a better response than that. My goodness. Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. We've really been so excited about this opportunity, and I'm someone who loves to come to these lectures as well. It's a really great program, and thank you to Tom for inviting us to be guests. As he introduced, I'm Sarah Marty. This is Joshua Calhoun, in case you were confused. And we started a program called Holding History in summer of 2015, and tonight we're going to share kind of two aspects of what we're working on in the program. This year's theme is the nature of the book, and we're coming at it from a couple of different angles. The first is, what are books made from? And what can we learn by thinking about what books or manuscripts or various media items are made from? And then the other piece...
I heard trees in the audience.
You heard trees? There are some from trees. Good. What else are they made from?
Straw.
What else? Skin. There's a lot of things, right? There's a lot of things they could be made from. And then our other part of the year, working with our student curator team, is also thinking about our relationships with nature. So what are the stories that we tell? How do we talk about nature? How do we paint, illustrate? What are all the different ways that we use books to talk about that relationship and reflect upon our own place in nature? So that's the nature of the book, and we'll have parts of both of that in tonight's talk. I get it? We're good?
That sounds
all right. Josh is going to start us off with the science portion of the evening from a humanist. It's going to be great. He's doing some really amazing work, and he's going to start with what books are made from and much, much more. So take it away, Josh.
Yeah, well, thank you for being here. We're excited. It's been a really great collaboration with Sarah. And so part of what we'll talk about is some of the research that I do. And then when we work in Holding History in the archives, we sort of put our two skill sets together as an artistic director, as somebody who geeks out of books a lot in the rare books archives. We put that together and are able to create a public humanities program that is allowing us, instead of sort of stepping up and presenting like we are tonight, like, let me tell you what I know. we call it mentoring-driven public humanities. So we work with the students, we work with a select group of students who we train, and then we have a science fair style session in special collections where people come in, and you'll see more of that tonight, but we just sort of, it's a very, it allows us to do a program that is mentor-based, and then you get to talk to excited students about really cool books on those nights that we have these events. But we're gonna talk, we're planning the theme for this year, we think about the nature of the book, and so I wanna talk to you a little bit about that. The reason that I do some research on this, I like to say that my research and my writing, my reading, lots of other things, sort of revolve around three things that I think everybody should love, or there's something wrong with you. And those three things are obviously Shakespeare, nature, and books. So Shakespeare, nature, and books. I get to just really think about that a lot. I grew up in the Adirondack Mountains of New York. You may not know where the Adirondacks are, but you do know where the Miracle on Ice took place, and you had a guy in that. And that's right around where I grew up. A lot of times people say, I don't know the Adirondacks. But the Miracle on Ice was right near my home, and I had friends who got cheap tickets because we were supposed to get killed. That's where I grew up, and I grew up in the Adirondack Park in a place where I spent a lot of, was able to spend a lot of time in a very interesting forest preserve that is half private land, approximately, in half public land, 6 million acres. You could fit. Yellowstone, Everglades, Glacier, and Grand Canyon National Parks inside the Adirondack Park. There's 100 towns inside it as well. So it's one of those places in the United States where you don't just go into, pay your entrance fee, camp, and leave. You live inside this place that is supposedly forever wild. How do you do that? So that's an interesting negotiation. It makes me think a lot about conservation. We're going to get maybe to some Aldo Leopold at the end, but that's certainly, I was reading him a long time ago. So I'm also an affiliate faculty of the Nelson Institute for Environmental Studies and with CHE, the Center for the Cultural History and the Environment. And it's been really just wonderful being here and having at least, well, I thought I'd have more snow, but everybody told me it'd be cold when I came here. It hasn't been cold enough. I would take more snow. I still have the studded tires on my bike, and I wish I needed them. when I teach, every class that I teach, I take them into our special collections library, and I have them just get this hands-on experience, and it's really important to me for every class I teach, because I'm teaching often Renaissance poetry. I do teach some environmental humanities, but still, I take everybody up there. And what's really important to me to show them there is something that I think is very important to them. We have so many amazing students here at the university, and they all have big ideas, and they all want to go out and do something with their ideas, just like everybody else who is brilliant across time, right? Everyone who is brilliant across time, whether they were scientists, an artist, whether they were writing music, whatever it was, when they had a really good idea, they all came up against the same problem, which is, now how do I make this idea into something that I can hold in my hands and share with others? It's that simple question that we just always come back against when we have a good idea. How do I hold it? How do I share it? And when we go up into the archives, we could see thousands of years of examples of how people have done that in the past. And I think that's exciting because my students then are taking their phones out and taking pictures and sharing that with someone else electronically. They're thinking about, okay, but my big idea, how will I share that? And I know some of you, maybe you have a Kindle, maybe some of you hate the Kindle, maybe you're against electronic books, but the fact is, we're all figuring out how to share our ideas in some physical way with others. And of course, when we talk about an electronic text, we do mean a physical way. We're talking about a lot of rare earth minerals in that case. Today, what we're going to do is we're going to kind of focus on making media. I'll leave it at that, and we're going to talk about a few different ways of making, the making that we're doing through this program, and with nature of the book. So, making media is kind of where we'll begin. This funny picture, we never found a replacement for this picture.
We didn't. No.
Oh yeah.
It works.
This is a placeholder picture. But this placeholder picture, it just what I want to talk about a little bit is because Tom mentioned it last week, is this move in this video. This is to remind me that I'm supposed to put scrolls and text up here, which you know you see. There's scrolls, okay, and these are from these ones I think are from the reign of Richard II. And then there's some books back here. There's a Bible. So really what I want you to focus on, I actually have a laser pointer, which I never have. So I'm just going to use that. It feels weird pointing at myself. So we have these scrolls, and then here's the Bible here. Now, there's something interesting about that Bible. It's a 1535 Coverdale Bible. And one of the things I like to do is hand it to you and say, can you find John 3:16? Which you can. And it's not because they don't know their Bible. It might be that too, but it's because there's no John 3:16 in this Bible. There is a John 3a and a John 3b and a John 3c. But there's not a John 3:16 because it doesn't have verses. Why doesn't it have verses? Well, the explanation is these little guys right here. The Bible was written as a scroll. So as so many books were, and it's you scroll through. And it changes when it goes to what we call a codex. The entire game is changed. The way you read it is different. You can compare one thing with another. When you're reading a scroll, you have a narrative. So you read like if you read the first chapter, you know, Genesis, Exodus. That's just we're just going through the story of Israel here. But if you want to do comparative reading back and forth, then you would have a codex where you can flip back and forth. You start using bookmarks. Bookmarks are just you might think of them as extracorporeal fingers. Right, bookmarks are just holding. If you ran out of fingers and you have to hold your place in it, right? And there's holding place so you can go back and forth, so you can flip around. So the move from scrolls to codices, we think about the format, it really changes the way we read. And we're seeing it again today with when we scroll on a screen. Some of you, if you think about something you read online, you can't visualize it in the same way as if you read it in a book, right? There's not that, because you're moving through and you don't have those breaks that you're used to. So we could talk about that a lot, but when I think about formatting with books like this, the format does so much. The format changes so much of what we understand. It changes the way that we read a text. It changes the way that we interpret it. The Reformation does not, the Protestant Reformation, it doesn't happen with a Bible on scrolls. It just doesn't. It's not, there's you were talking about what the cause and effect is. There's a much bigger question. But it's really that once we move into the codex or codices, you start to have a different way of reading the Bible. We see that quite clearly in the history of media. So what we're thinking about then, all right, is format and function and form, right? So the format, we could call that form, the scroll or a codex, how that tells us how it functions, how it helps it function, and then when we think about the way we read it, how that has a formal effect of the way that we understand it, the way we interact with that text. But something that I've been thinking more and more about lately is going back just a little before format. Think about the flora and fauna. Think about what the format is made from, and how does that affect the way we read? How does the presence of animals or plants or something like that affect the way that we read text? And so if we think about, for instance, just something basic, like the shift to me that's as equally interesting to me from scrolls to codices is the shift from parchment to paper. I'm going to use the word parchment here to mean vellum and all those. Let's call them skins. Shift from skins to paper. And how does that change the way we read? How does that change the way we make books? Well, for one thing, England, right? I studied Renaissance England. They're a net exporter of books until papermaking arrives. And after that, it's another 400 years before they're a net exporter of books. They're importing more books than they're exporting. So papermaking, for one thing, it changes the ecology. You think about the ecology of England. They're importing plants in the forms of books from other from the continent, from other places, right? Whereas before they were sending their animals off to other nations. So it has an economic effect. But The thing that I focus on, especially, is paper making itself, and that shift. One thing we could say, in the same way that the scroll changes the way we read the Bible, I'll give you a little tiny example. Paper changes the way we read the Bible too. So, in 1611, there's this famous Bible, the King James Bible. And it's notable for a lot of reasons, but what it's not notable for is something I think it should be more notable for. How many of you have heard of the Scarlet Letter? Well, the idea in the Scarlet Letter is that Hester Prynne sins, and because she sins, she has to be marked as a sinner, right? For the rest of her life. Now, I would argue that that is coming not out of the Bible, but out of the King James Bible, specifically. It's coming out of a Bible that's using paper technology. And what happens if you're using a scroll, if you're using a piece of parchment, animal skin, and you make a mistake, you raise, or we'd use the word erase. You literally take a knife and you scrape the skin, and then you have a fresh surface. Now, if you get in there, you get really close, you could see the difference. But there are still, we found some good erasures and rewritings in things like Petrarch that we hadn't noticed. I mean, they're still finding things that a very good scribe covered up very well, right? So you make an error. Let's say you're David. King David, and let's say you, take Bathsheba, get her pregnant, and then kill her husband, for instance. And then you go to God and you say in a psalm that they, in the Renaissance, they read over and over, and every single month they would have read the psalm, Psalm 51. He says, hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities, he says in the Bible. But he doesn't say that until the King James Bible. He says, and wipe out. Before that, he says, and erase. And raise out, and wash out. He uses every word for removing the sin prior to this time. And all of those words mean make it go away, make it invisible. And then he uses the word blot out. What happens when we have a blot? Right? It's like, here's the mistake I make, and here's the correction above it, the scarlet letter. Right? That this is an idea of the way that we mark sin as something that's happened and we have to mark it out. And it's not, this word blotting is not in the Bible prior to the 1550s. It's in a couple times prior to the King James Bible. The word blot appears in the King James Bible 30 times. So it just suddenly just appears, and it's because that's how you make a correction on paper. So the shift from a plant medium to an animal medium to a plant medium has a dramatic effect on the way we think about sin, or the way that people have thought about sin across the ages. So papermaking, then, is clearly, if you haven't figured it out, is where I get excited about papermaking. Papermaking is for most of the history of printing, books are being printed on paper made from recycled clothing, not from trees. We'll talk about that, but really it's after the Civil War that we start to get mass-produced paper made from trees. So here's an example. These are some from 1557. This is Thomas More. This is a bit of flax. So if you have like linen, or if you have like rough linen, you'll see these, we call it a shive or a husk that's in the paper. It's over here. I've already forgotten I have the pointer. I'm gonna go back to that. It's such a treat. I'm not used to it. So you see it over there, and here it is big, right? This is this mass that's cutting through John 14. Over here, do you see this? This is just a whole piece of cloth right in the paper, right? So this is being made from recycled rags. This tradition comes all the way forward. If you read, like, Farmer Boy, Little House on the Prairie, right? Almanza's mom is trading rags to Nick the Tin Peddler. There's a Bob Dylan song, the Rag Man, right? Just something up and down the street. I can't think of the song right now. But anyway, there's the Rag and Bone Man is collecting rags for making paper and bones for making a gelatin that's going to cover that paper. So this is what paper is made of, and people are aware that it's coming from their clothing, which was prior to that a plant. And it gets played upon. Here we are. Okay, now we are in the Revolutionary War. 1777. All right. Now, here it says, young ladies are assured that by sending to the paper mill an old handkerchief no longer fit to cover their snowy breasts, there is a possibility of its returning to them again in the form of, in a more pleasing form of a billet doux from their lovers. So what they're having, a crisis, Benjamin Franklin had started a competition with the American Philosophical Society for finding a replacement plant to make paper from, because they were a nation of letters, but they were importing all the rags to be able to write their make their declarations upon. And so here they are in 1777. Look, ladies, you can't fight, but you know what you can do? You can recycle. And you know what? It might actually, your rags might come back to you. By the way, they had to really, really push for the recycling of rags, because there's a lot of things you could do with rags in a colonial area, from rag rugs to insulation, cleaning, whatever else you might want to do. So it's quite a campaign. Darn Hunter says that, who's he's talking about papermaking in pioneer America, says, by examining 17th, 18th, and early 19th century American-made paper, it's possible to detect the various difficulties and hardships that were encountered by the mill workers and to trace every step of the procedure, from the initial sorting of the rags to the final drying and finishing of the paper. I'm going to show you one cool example that we have next door, and then we're going to talk a little bit about how we're getting hands-on with this to learn more about it. So this is a cool book called, from 1800. It's called A Historical Account. Oops, Sam. Well, I'm showing you another page. Let me pop it back so you can see that title. A Historical Account of the Substances Which Have Been Used. Let's see if it's going to pop up here for us.
To describe events.
Yeah, I'm gonna not click one more time. Okay, hold on. I'm gonna click one more time. If it goes away, we're gonna go with it. Okay, here we go. See this. So substances which have been used to describe events and to convey ideas. Substances used to convey ideas. Substances as conveyances for our ideas. 1800, they're having a little trouble in England. They're having another economic crisis, and this is Coops makes this straw paper. And he says, I got the solution. This is the first paper also made with, he not only with straw paper, he's making it with, he's got the first steam-driven, I'm trying not to get too technical. Anyway, he's quite the entrepreneur, and he's saying, look, we can keep this at home. We can make paper here. It's going to be just as good. This is addressed to King George III, and I'll give you a little close-up of it. Now, this is, I mean, he's saying, like, look, this is rough, but we could do better. This is before they're really using bleach, too, although he did experiment that eventually. So you can see how much stuff is in that. Now, you look at that and say, well, that's really dirty paper. That's not really dirty paper. That's, if you spend a lot of time looking at older books, a lot of the books look like this. They're flecked with matter. They're not homogeneous in the way that we think paper is. They show signs of being made from plants, of being made from the clothing of other people who wore those plants. Recently, to do some stuff we're doing with the Holding History crew, we got a USB microscope, so I got to do it even more. that's what the type looks like under the microscope. And here's, you see these, again, these shives, these big pieces of straw. So what you see there then is just this awareness that there's a scarcity of the materials you need to make paper, and awareness that there's a scarcity of the natural materials you need to convey ideas. Do we value conveying our ideas? Yes, so we need to find a new ecological solution. That's the whole argument of this. I'm going to show you this is a modern artist that's from a small colonial paper mill, but what I'm going to do is actually, I'm going to skip forward and show you, this is even better, this will give you a better sense of it. This is our crew, and then after this I'm going to turn it over to Sarah. This is our crew, our Holding History crew from 2 years ago, making paper here locally. You see how it works.
I think it's really important to show the hand, and you know, it's a conflict, because a well-made thing can look very industrial or mechanical, or so it's to know what you're looking at is important sometimes. I'm rocking the paper forward and back. see that. So paper, handmade paper does not have grain. You know paper grain?
Yeah.
So what we do is we rock and lay down, gently press, see how the water comes up, and just rock out. Oops, the other way.
Wow. So Barton's an old hat at it, or a young hat with a lot of experience. How's that? You would be an old hat.
Is it old hat? Is that the same?
It is, yeah. Yeah. Yep.
That's a thickie.
Yeah.
Let's have just a little water. A little water, maybe.
Well, this started out as a baled straw on the land, and it has to be cooked and washed and cut, and then we start here, and then by tomorrow at this time it would be dry. This is rag paper. Paper's made from rags. But that's what we have here. So hopefully you'll find the torn edges all on one side, and you know your deckled edges on the other. Hopefully much like the books that you're looking at. And so there's a lot of tradition in book arts and paper making that fill these rooms.
Jump in. I did want to acknowledge the fact that Josh actually was the filmmaker on that particular video. It's a skill set that he has that a lot of folks are not aware of, and he's a very talented filmmaker. So, one
so
of what we
make
hope
money off, and I'm making money.
Art is not about money. I know that. I'm in theater. but I just wanted to say that, just so you knew he was a talented filmmaker as well. I'm going to talk for a little bit about the idea of making and mentorship, and when we think about making in holding history, a lot of it is about learning and gaining a different understanding. To go to special collections and see a book under glass is a very different experience than to go to special collections and be able to touch the paper, which is a different experience than to be able to make paper and then touch the paper, and maybe smell the book, and maybe even turn the pages. Different levels of understanding. They're all good, but they're all different. How many folks here had a chance to see the first folio when it was at the Chazen Museum in the fall? Hands nice and high. It was a really wonderful, wonderful opportunity for the state of Wisconsin. You know, the UW-Madison Libraries in partnership with the Arts Institute and the Chazen were the location in our state for the first folio to be here for an entire month. We had a whole year of Shakespeare programming. It was pretty incredible. When you went to see the folio, where was it? What was it? Under glass. Now, it's amazing to get to see it, but what was that experience like for you as a community member? Incredible to be there, to be able to hold your hand close to it, to be able to be this close to that book, but it's behind the glass. It's like the fourth wall in theater. There was distance. We understand why. There's a limited number of copies. We want to make sure we keep the book safe. But your experience and my experience was different. We couldn't turn the page. We couldn't feel the cover. We couldn't smell the book, right? So A few things to think about with that first folio, since a lot of us had a chance to read about it or to see the museum. A few facts from the Folger Library from their page, and also from Josh's first folio talk when he introduced the exhibit in November. The folio is about 900 pages. 900 pages. Remember that number, because when we talk about how books are made, that'll seem even bigger than it is. There are about 750 or so printed. One of the things that I didn't know until your talk was they tended to make limited runs because it was an industry, and if you just printed boundless copies, people would be out of work. So instead, we do the run, then we take everything apart, and then next time we need another run, we can employ all those typesetters and everyone else to put it back together. So that was interesting. It took a team of 5 compositors, the folks that set the type, about 2 years to put the whole thing together. So when we talk about typesetting, think about that. 5 people, 2 years to set all those pages, all those words. No two are alike because the hand is such an involved part of the process of producing, so everyone is unique. Just kind of tuck that away as we talk through this part of the program. The making portion is pretty spectacular because the opportunity it affords us. It's also really fun because the student curator team and the two of us get to work together with hands-on activities and working with mentors in the community, starting with paper making with the rubber, with the wonderful, wonderful Robert Pussell. He's a master paper maker, master artisan. He's faculty member over at Edgewood College, works in the stream, has a beautiful paper studio. He's been so generous with his time working with us and working with our students. And for most of us, this is the first time we'd ever even thought of how paper was made. We had no idea. This is what paper is to us. Completely disposable. I mean, I don't know about you, but I didn't even start recycling paper until, like, I don't know, 15 years ago, maybe. I grew up, this was nothing, right? What do we have? We have facial tissue. We have things that we throw away. It's bleached. It's not very personal. I'm just going to pass it around and play with this for a little bit, right? So I didn't have a great relationship with paper. I don't know, we didn't think we were friends, right? We don't, paper doesn't matter to me. Then we do this workshop, and students get a chance to learn about that history and that great tradition and hundreds of years of craftsmanship that go into creating this surface that we can use to capture our ideas and make books. Just go with a little bit with that. I'm going to pass another thing around. More hand than stuff. So we go from sheets of paper to notebooks. When I taught my arts entrepreneurship class this fall, we did a journal project, and I gave every student a pad of paper at the beginning of class. And you would have thought that I gave them a bar of gold. Pad of paper. Everybody was so excited they had their own notebook just for class. So a notebook. This is an improvement over a single sheet. Right? Still pretty uniform, but a nice thing. Feel that. Feel the paper, feel the texture. And the last piece that I have is the notebook that Robert showed us at the end of the video. So after we had the papermaking workshop, got a chance to get our hands dirty and learn a little bit about how it's crafted, he made rag paper notebooks for everybody at the first holding history session. This is Robert's work. His workmanship, his pages. This is rag paper. What does it mean to get a notebook like this? That feeling is the same feeling we have when we get to work in the Rare Book Archives and we have when we get to do an event and share those archives with you. It's a very different experience. So pass that around. Beyond paper making, we also had the opportunity to work with the Text Technologies Lab, which is in the School of Library and Information Studies in Helen C. White here on campus. And this was our first opportunity to get to do this. If you look really closely, these are trays. Do you guys, have you ever heard uppercase and lowercase? Josh, can you explain?
Yeah, you really is literally, you have a your type case that you're going to take your letters from, and there's one that's lower, and that has small letters, and there's one that's higher, upper, and that is the capital letters, right? So it's literally lowercase and uppercase. And the same thing, we get things like mind your P's and Q's. If you think about a piece of type, P's and Q's look about the same. Mind your P's and Q's.
Right. And that's from mind your pipes and ports.
It is. It is also from mind your P's and Q's, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so it's for these, when you're handling the type, and the same, U's and N's get
mixed
up. But we don't
get
to mind your U's and N's, though.
It doesn't sound as nice.
Yeah.
So, and when you look at this little picture, every single little tray is a different letter, right? So when we're there trying to set words, we set phrases, we tried to set holding history, but we didn't quite get the upside down and backwards, so it printed this way instead, you know, it's a learning opportunity. You have to take each piece out one at a time, one letter at a time, and you're lining them up, and they have to be put in the right direction. It's not the way you think it needs to be, and then you still try to correct it, and that's what happens. But it takes a long, long time. And I brought, just as a, this is a visual aid, a stamp where all the letters are already pressed in. But imagine if you were lining up each of these letters one at a time with a tiny, tiny piece of tape. How long would it take you to set 900 pages? Right, we spent maybe an hour working on this, and we successfully set some form of a maybe 4 or 5 word phrase with each team of two. Now, we're not obviously professional compositors, but it gives you a new appreciation when you have a book in your hand and it's been hand set, hand typed. And then at a SLIS, they have a clamshell press at the top. So our students, this is Shauna up here working with Josh, each got to practice with the type that they set to see what it looked like at the end of it. So it's a really great opportunity. If you're in Helen C. White, you can stop by. It's open to the public. One of our students, Kieran, is one of the staff members there who's working with it. And you get a chance as well to practice that and see if that changes your understanding of what it means to make a book. Another one of our...
And this face, by the way, like that's...
That's the best face ever.
Teaching in class, like that's very typical, right? That moment that thing mm-hmm. you made comes out, even if you made it backwards.
Doesn't matter.
Shauna's face is just sort of, it was the perfect moment, whoever took that shot. Was that you?
It was me.
Good job.
Yeah, mm-hmm. thanks. You know. So book DNA question mark. Another one of our hands-on activities. Why question mark? So Josh has been working with Matthew Collins at York University on a new project. Matthew Collins is a zooarchaeologist. If we take that word apart, we have zoology and archaeology. And when you put them together, what do you think he's working on? Zoology and archaeology. Anybody have any ideas?
Egyptian mummified animals?
Animals. There's some animals in there. It's a pretty good guess.
Used to be,
yeah. Yeah, used to be, exactly. One of his recent projects, was looking at the dairying practices of Northern Europe during the Iron Age. And they were looking at pottery shards, and they could pull milk residues off the pottery, and they could figure out what kind of milk it was. Was it from a cow? Was it from a goat? And then they're trying to infer back off of that data. So what they are doing in this project, which Josh is part of, we were able to work with our holding history students to gather samples from some of the books that are made from animals in special collections here on our campus. And you can see two of our students here, Alex and Ryan, have tiny little erasers, and they're creating shavings off of the manuscript paper that then go into a little test tube and get shipped back. Why would we care what they're made out of? Anybody have any ideas? Why would we care? Any thoughts?
You can tell.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you be able to tell which animal and get an idea of what location it came from based on how many, what kind of genetic map you have?
That's the hope. So if we can figure out what kind of skin it is, and if also if it's a book, is it all the same kind of animal, or are the outside pages a goat and the inside pages are a cow? I don't know. So they're trying to identify the animal species and then see if it's consistent through or if it changes and if there's any kind of pattern, and then try to trace that back to where it might be from.
And also breeding practices. You can see mm-hmm. the change over once you begin to build a database. But like the holding history backwards, you know, I said to Matthew, hey, could you send a little test kit for me to use with the holding history kids? Stuart is here, and he was in the past picture, but you're not kids. I know you're not kids, but like, you know what I mean. That's affectionate. So he'd send me a test kit, and he did, and then we got all ready, and then those of you who are scientists, what do you see that like just kind of bugs you right now? Maybe the gloves? Those are not the gloves we should be using. So the question is, we may have compromised the sample by using the wrong gloves. And it's a learning experience, but you know, I actually didn't know this, and the two students at the bottom who are
pre-med
and biochem were like, oh, these aren't the right, you know.
So we might get to do the samples again, but it's still an amazing opportunity for us to be able to bring undergraduates into special collections and to be part of this international project. That's new ideas, new technology, new thoughts.
Normally, I don't have to buy the gloves. I didn't know.
No, I know. Farm and fleet. Okay. That's what we use for the dairy farm too. We always wear gloves when you're cleaning all the cows. The last section for the hands-on portion of some of the mentorship training that we have is working in special collections. As Josh mentioned, he does a lot of work with his classes in special collections, and we're really lucky because we're able to set up special sessions for the holding history team where we can go in as a small group, either with, you know, anywhere from 3 to 10 of us, and we learn about what it is to be a scholar and a researcher in special collections. We learn, I call it the care and feeding, so things like how do you properly pick up a book? How do you properly put the book on a table? What's the right way to turn the page so as to do the least amount of damage? What do you do when you're done with the book? That's, you know, care and feeding. How do I find things? There's thousands and thousands and thousands of books in the vault. I don't even know where to start.
What's that thing?
And right, oh my gosh, yeah. What's this thing? The card catalog? This is like a whole new, this is surprising to many, many folks. And how does it work? And why isn't it the same as the computer database? Sometimes this is more information. So all these different ways that we can find information. And this gives us, this is very different than the computer. The computer, I type a word in, brings a bunch of stuff up. Here, I pull out the drawer that might just be the M drawer. Who knows what I'm going to find when I'm flipping through? So it's that idea of opening up the process of discovery using multiple modes and being open to finding new things. Maybe what you think you're looking for isn't actually what you're looking for, and you'll find something else way more interesting and more fun as you, you know, as you're going through it. So the idea of being comfortable in the space, being curious, knowing to ask questions, and starting to build that expertise. And the last part of it that I think is really part of the genius of what we've been able to do is we have all these students from different disciplines, pre-med, art history, elementary education, zoology, we have a zoology museum, astrophysics, totally different backgrounds. It brings a whole new understanding of the field when you're a pre-med student, like Alex Smith, who pulls a text from 1605 on childbirth, and she's just read what do you expect when you're expecting in one of her classes, and she starts comparing the two texts. What's the same in the 1605 text is a more modern text, and what's totally different? It gives her a new understanding of medicine when you go through that. So, I caught most of it.
It's a good
overview, quick journey through about a semester's worth of training for our new curatorial team. So
we're gonna wrap it up with this question of making memories. Now, I'm gonna take some guidance on time here because, you know, we could talk about the biodeterioration of books, or we could zip through it and you know, I'll kind of like, you know, if you're interested, lean forward a little bit. You want me to move forward, let us wrap up the Q&A. I could, you know, it's okay. But because we wanted to make sure we had enough cool stuff to show you, at some point we just started cutting stuff anyway. So when you're talking about making memories, when we think about the ecology of a book or the nature of a book, a lot of times we go up to the archive and say, this is the nature of the book. But the fact that we are able to look at that book is also about nature. It's about ecology. Because these books, they just weren't supposed to be here, many of them. In the early 17th century, Francis Bacon was trying to learn how to refrigerate a chicken, stuffing snow inside the cavity of a chicken, and he got a cold and he died. They didn't understand that we were going to refrigerate their books and keep them alive. They had no clue. It's been said in the past that the cost of art is the destruction of a living tree. Now the cost of preservation of art is often the destruction of a fossilized tree. We are keeping these, with HVAC systems, we're keeping these books and archives at a regular temperature, regular humidity, so that we can preserve them. Why? You know, what is the cost? Why is it worth doing that? And so we talked a little bit about holding and sharing with others, but also, you know, how do we preserve these things? In Hamlet, Hamlet says, how long will a man lie in the earth ere he rot? Remember, this is the gravedigger scene, alas, poor York. The gravedigger says, faith, if you be not rotten before you die, you will last you some 8 year, 9 year. A tanner will last you 9 year. Hamlet, why he more than another? Why, sir, His hide is so tanned with his trade that he will keep out water a great while, and your water is a sore decay of your horse and dead body. So now let's just think about this in a sense of a book, right? You die, there's this idea that leather is going to, you know, something tanned is going to last longer, right? You die, you decay, but maybe the book is going to last longer, but it's still going to decay as well. But we're able to keep them from decaying. I do Renaissance poetry. When I go to look up like scientific definitions, I don't expect to find Renaissance poetry. But when I looked up the definition of biodeterioration a year or so ago, I just started writing around it because I love this. H.J. Hook, who's credited with coining this term, any undesirable change in the properties of a material caused by the vital activities of organisms. Now, John Donne could have written this. Any undesirable change in the properties of a material. Okay, all right. I mean, we get that, right? We wanted this to stay alive, and it died, and it's an undesirable change. Like, we get that. But then this little addition, right? Caused by the vital activities. They're just trying to live. We don't like it, they do. It's a competition of in an ecosystem. And so this language of biodeterioration, it really has pervaded the way that I think about what we're doing with the archives. Here's this first folio. It was a pleasure to have it here, but I mean, I hope that people didn't think these are what rare books are like partially open just enough so you can kind of peek inside with a guard standing over it and low lighting. We don't have a first folio next door from that at the Special Collections. We have a second folio. We have the second printing of Shakespeare's sonnets, and I'll put it in your hands and let you. Well, I can't hold it, but I can let you
flip the pages.
Yeah. So I spent a lot of time doing research. Here's Shakespeare's first folio. I spent a lot of time in as an example of biodeterioration and the ways we might think about this. I spent time in the Folger Shakespeare Library in Washington D.C. Last time I was there, I was looking at this is John Donne's epitaph for his wife. It's probably in his hand. Probably John Donne, the famous metaphysical poet, wrote this in his own hand, his epitaph for his wife, that was then copied onto, engraved into a monument, which then disappeared. It was destroyed in a remodeling of the church. So this is the survival of John Donne's epitaph for his wife, not on stone, but on paper. And I got to thinking about this sort of stone versus paper, and Shakespeare says, talks about that he's going to write his sonnets, not marble or the gilded monuments, but paper is going to preserve his beloved. And Ben Jonson calls the first folio a living monument. At the Folgers, it's really true, because here's something kind of crazy. This is in John Donne's hand before 1630, okay? Now, this outside the Folger is from 1930. There's a series of bas-reliefs on the outside. It's in white Georgia marble. They were made in 1930. It's the same white Georgia marble that the Lincoln statue is made out of. We're looking at Hamlet here. Now let's see what's happening. Here's a little map. Here's what's happening to it. It's a claim durability notwithstanding. The marble book, now you can't really see, but you see this, you see this guy over here. We're going to zoom in there, okay? We're going to go, here's Hamlet, here's his book, all right? So the book inside the Folger looks great. Let's see what the book outside the Folger looks like in marble. There's the book outside. It's crumbling. That's not my finger, but I did not do that. Hamlet's marble book is crumbling. Falstaff has a terrible case of pock marks, which maybe from the pox. I mean, this might be appropriate for Falstaff. But here's my favorite, okay, when we think of biodeterioration. We're getting literary here for a second. So here's Romeo and Juliet, okay? So we're looking now at two of literature's most well-known lovers being wrenched apart all over again. In comparison to the other nine marble reliefs, Romeo and Juliet have withstood erosion quite well. Many of the others are worse than this. But the decay in the form of gypsum staining and biological spores is taking its toll. The growth is especially heavy. Right there, it's between They're almost touching lips in between their interlaced fingers. Here, the marble surface is worn down, allowing biological spores to take root in the porous cavity of stone. Having taken root and without treatment, these spores will multiply. The words that appear in the conservator's assessment are, quote, kill the growth. That's the assessment. Growth, of course, being what Hooke would call a humanly undesirable change caused by the vital activities of these spores, right? And yet it's perfectly natural for spores to desire the cave, the cavities of marble. In fact, it's as natural for spores to desire the cavities of marble as it is for teenagers to desire each other. And in this case, it's as deadly. At the level of spores and stone, conservators, we are the unyielding parents, fighting to keep the undesirable but vital activities of procreation at bay. And here you can see just a little bit more closely what's happening there. So when we think about, as Shakespeare thought about, you know, not marble, the gilded monument, we think about stone, keeping a stone monument, we think about writing an epitaph saying, hey, engrave this, and it turns out the paper lasts and the stone doesn't. When we think about holding an idea and sharing it with others, it's always a choice. It's a choice about what materials we're going to use. I'm going to end my little section with this to say, these are my three favorite mugs. The one in the middle is the one I use all the time. That's my daily mug. And then the one on the right my daughter made for me. And you know, it's not the most symmetrical mug you've ever seen. But she made it for me. I love it. And it's a little bit, you know, I'm afraid the handle's gonna fall out, so I use it sparingly, right? And the one on the left, my sister, who was a year older than me, and we were very close. She gave that to me, and she passed away almost 15 years ago now. And you can see that one's not in good shape. But, you know, on certain days, when I'm thinking about her, I take it out and I drink from it. I put it away very carefully, right, and keep it there. I can't use it every day. And as I want to think about the containers, these are all three, they all contain coffee, the same coffee that I make. All three will hold the same coffee. But they do different things. They have different resonances. They tell different stories. And when we think about the containers that we put our ideas into, they do something to it. They change. If you have it on, if you write a love note on that white piece of paper, it's different than if you write it on that yellow ruled paper. It's different than if you write it on that last piece of paper that went circulating around that I noticed took a little longer to circulate. It's different. And these are different containers. So when we go to special collections, we have a very similar thing happening. We show different books, and some of them are in rough shape, and we only show them very carefully. Some of them we show on a regular basis, but we're really thinking about these ideas and the containers that hold them, and then our stewardship of those ideas. Because that's really what we're thinking about, is the stewardship not only of our own ideas, putting them in good containers, but the stewardship of the ideas that other people have put into the containers that they've shared with us.
So the last little portion, then we'll go into the Q&A, is thinking about this idea of the many meanings of stewardship. You know, the first meaning is maybe more along the lines of preserving and conserving, and thinking about all the ways that you keep things. You keep things in a library, you keep things in an archive. But we also like to think about stewardship as being about relationships and building a community of folks who are having engaging conversations around interesting topics, much like Wednesday Night at the Lab is a community of folks who want to have an intellectual conversation and a conversation about ideas that are of interest and are complicated and aren't cut and dry, aren't black and white. All the making that we do, the paper making, the setting of type, the putting words backwards, the researching, the finding things in the stacks, the learning how to use a card catalog, talking about typewriters versus computers, all of those hands-on activities lead us up to the culmination of the program, which is a public event, our keynote event that we do once a semester in Special Collections, where we invite folks like you to come and join us for an evening to meet our student curators, to hear about the research that they've been doing, to hear about their backgrounds, what they've learned, to ask questions, to have conversations, to bring your knowledge to the table as well, and to engage with these amazing, amazing, amazing books we have in the archives. We have an event coming up On April 4th, we'll be putting information up on that, and we would love for you to come and join us and get a chance to see the work that we do, to see Special Collections, and to meet our fantastic student curator team. When we talk about holding history, we often talk about the Wisconsin idea, the idea of you learn together, you learn as a community, and you make that community bigger by inviting other people in and by sharing the resources of the campus with the community. We've been so lucky to have the support of the UW-Madison Libraries, of the Anonymous Fund, the Knapp Fund, the Brittingham Fund, and folks from the community for this program and to be able to offer this opportunity. I'm going to close with a story of what an impact this program has had. We were lucky enough to have the Odyssey Project students in Special Collections for a special class last February. And it was our first curatorial team. At that point, we were doing a whole year of Shakespeare, all Shakespeare all the time. And the Odyssey Project is for adult, returning adult students whose lower socioeconomic status who are now getting their degrees. And their first class is a humanities-based class where they read Shakespeare. And one of our student curators had a 1640 printing of the sonnets. And one of the undergraduate students who was attending found the sonnet she had memorized for class in print in 1640. Pulled up a chair and touched the page and said, "I wonder how many other people have read my sonnet." Connecting almost 400 years of readers, of people who love learning, who love literature, and someone else who'd been on the same journey that she was now on, telling that story through a book. With that, we hope that you'll come join us on April 4th for Holding History and meet our new team and be part of the program in the future. Thank you. Any questions? Yes, please.
Do you also collect anything like film or other archives of other media?
So the center.
Can you repeat the question for the people?
Sure. So the question was, does Special Collections in the Memorial Library collect film and other media? On campus, there's a fantastic archive called the Center for Film and Theater Research. It's in the Wisconsin Historical Society building on Library Mall, that beautiful one with the beautiful the marble pillars on the front of it. And they have a fantastic archive. You can search a lot of it online. They have the Trumbo papers, a lot from theater and from Hollywood, going all the way back to the 1910s and up through. And really great curators and librarians. You can send them any question you want, make an appointment, and they'll pull the boxes and you can see or watch anything you'd like. Any more questions? Yes?
Does the library actively search for old new material to put in? I mean, is there people out looking for old books that they can bring to the library?
Yeah, absolutely. So as all libraries have this problem, you know, the space, you know, how much space they have, but they're we're not at capacity in the sense that I don't work at the library, but I do a lot of teaching. And so Robin Ryder, who's the director of Special Collections, or the head curator of Special Collections, and now Dave Pavlichu, who's just come in and is directing that space, they're getting new books, and they ask me. I mean, this is one of the great things about being here. Is they say, you know, what do you need for teaching? You know, and so they do get new books in. They also have the subscription to what they have. They've like a lot of not journals, but I guess artist books they have, and also the Kohler Art Library, the artist books, but different subscriptions for the little magazines collection that they get a lot of different things in. McSweeney's, which a lot of my students know is an online journal, but it has this amazing, I mean, it's actually how do you actually keep this thing on the shelf because it's in weird formats, but we have a subscription to McSweeney's, so that's constantly updating. Particular artists who are doing artist books or bookmakers, if they make a new one, we sort of automatically get it in. So they're continuing to collect, and then certainly there are donations. But sometimes people come in and they either say, what are you wanting to buy? Can I donate and donate a book in the sense of just use this for? Or I have something, and I'm afraid it's not being well preserved, and I'd like, you know, students to be able to interact with it. Can I give this to you? And I think I imagine they give you an honest assessment whether mm-hmm. that would be valuable to the collection.
Mm-hmm. I saw a hand in the back. Maybe your question was answered. Yeah, go ahead.
I wonder What do you think is being created in the past century that would be rare, or you think people centuries from now will find rare or most interesting?
So what do we think people centuries from now that's being created right now, what do they think will be rare or interesting 300 or 400 years in the future? If we take the first folio, 400 years. So 400 years from now, what are we doing right now folks will find interesting? I'm going to sort of answer your question. We're in a very interesting place in terms of media because it has changed so much in the last 100 years. Even if you go back to 1900, right? If we had recordings, it was maybe on a wax cylinder, tended to melt, not many opportunities to save anything. And we've gone from wax to records to vinyl to cassette tapes to reel-to-reel. There's all these different kinds of film. We've got all these different ways of holding things, all these different media technologies. And what we've started to do is have things we can no longer play or access. We have all of this, we have all this art and knowledge that is in a format we can't get to. How many folks had floppy disks? Right? Can you get to those floppy disks anymore? Did you ever get everything off of them before they went away? Mm-hmm. So I think what'll be interesting is to find all of this technology from the last century and try to figure out what it is and how it might have worked and what's in there, what's on there, because we're not transferring every time we make an upgrade, so to speak. So what'll be around and what story does it tell?
And in terms of the, you know, media objects, sometimes it's hard to know. I mean, you know, I mean, frankly, the first folio isn't that rare. There were 750 of them printed, and about 250 survived. That's not really
kind of amazing.
any real definition of rare. But there's we have some rare volumes certainly. Sometimes the moment you have to explain something to your kid. You ever kind of had that moment? And we went to my daughter is a big Hamilton fan, so we went to we were in Albany, New York. I grew up in upstate. We went to Albany, and there's this place. Now there's a Schuyler home, but there's also this place where the Schuylers lived before that. And there was a little placard and a little that just not much. It was but on the side of like a bank, you know. And my daughter was aghast.
That's appropriate.
How? Who would knock down the Schuyler sisters' home and put up a bank? Are you, you know, and we talked to, you know, she just this little iPod Touch I gave it, so the first one that came out. I said, you know, take your iPod Touch, take it to the museum. Tell them you want to donate it, see what they say. They don't want your iPod Touch. Take it in 300 years from now, the first iPod Touch, they want it, right? They're going to have trouble turning it on, but you know, but even if they could just stuck it like a brick in a case, right? This is a part, and maybe the case that's on it, maybe the stickers that are on it, they want too. Who knows? You know, when does something pass from being old to being special? And I think it's a really fun question. But, yeah.
So we have the molecular archaeology group here.
Mm-hmm.
When you were doing the raising of the vellum to get the cells, I'm wondering what's the state of the art in analyzing books that are 300, 400, 500 years old, not only for the DNA, but for the inks, for the paper, as you were talking about, and not just the DNA aspects, but what are people finding out using mass spectroscopy and other things to go along with the 7,000
I mean, so you're right, mass spectrometry, we're using, so right now, the project that we're doing here, you're taking a racer, this is an amazing realization, and this is where you start to have a collaboration. The state of the art is collaboration, I think, actually, to answer the question directly.
I think we'd love to do some stuff with you here.
Yeah, yeah.
With the mass specs and the DNA stuff.
No, I mean, there's probably no reason we should be sending you over to York University, except that that's who...
That's who asked us to be part of it.
Yeah, but what happened is Matthew and his team, Sarah Fidiament is a lead on that, realized that the way they were cleaning the parchments was these essentially PVC, like when there's smudges, they're cleaning with PVC, and that they could, what is the tribolytic effect, that it pulls the, essentially, it's like when you rub a balloon against your hair, it stands up on it, it's going to pull that, so we're actually looking at proteins, not DNA. Now, we don't have a non-destructive way to test the proteins. And this is what's interesting. Bruce Holsinger, who was here recently, was talking about this. If you find an old bone in the ground, you can cut that thing up, you send, you know, you could test it however you want. But if you find an old book in the ground, right? You can't cut the paint, you know. So we have a very, this comes back to this question of preservation. Like, why can't we cut a little shaving off of a Gutenberg Bible printed on vellum, one of the Gutenberg Bibles? Why does that make you a little uncomfortable if I say it like that? You know? And why not? So we could do DNA testing that way to learn a lot more about it. But right now we're doing proteins, also bacteria. A lot of there's some bacterial research working with a molecular anthropologist from the University of Oklahoma. But the collaboration is where the conversation happens. Because if you notice me, it's sort of like having to try to pull it. Is it the tripolytic effect? This is not what I do. They didn't teach me this in Bible school. I got a BS. Right? What I do is go in and I know about the books. And so in May, I'll go over to Oxford. We're doing a thing called Book 360. And it'll be a group of us. One is a parchment maker. So we're talking about making. One is a parchment maker in upstate New York. Archaeozoologist, molecular anthropologist, a number of also book historians like myself. And we're going to, the idea of 360, look at it from every angle, ask questions, kind of push these, sit down, have some meals together, and have a conversation around it. And that's where the stuff that seems to be coming out right now. I guess they're calling it STEAM these days, aren't they? STEM with the arts. But I think the state of the art is with collaborations.
We call it beer.
Beer, yeah. Steam Anchor, yeah, yeah.
Nice. Yes, go ahead.
I wonder if you could talk more about the class and the variety of students you get. Is the class cross-listed across different disciplines? Mm-hmm. And are the students, like, what makes the students take this class? What are they interested in the class? And are you seeing any, I'm very interested in science students. I'm a science librarian. So I'm very interested in science, STEM students looking at a book and not just seeing a text, but seeing data.
Sure. So we're actually not a credit course. This is an extracurricular activity. All the students who are involved are volunteering their time to be part of the program. The first round of student curators all were students who had taken classes with Josh. So they've been
Shakespeare courses.
Shakespeare courses.
They take in the archive and they go nuts.
And the first year we were going to talk about Shakespeare because it was the Shakespearean community MOOC happened on campus. We knew the year of Shakespeare was coming up. So that was a way to pull students in who like Shakespeare. And then we're going to do this thing with rare books. And then this second round of students that Stuart's part of, we had an application process. And it's what's been really fun is we have an interdisciplinary group. You know, everything from cosmology and astrophysics to pre-med to elementary education to art history. Many students are double majors, chemistry, double majors, triple majors. And it's very much an interdisciplinary activity. And what's fun about that is when you know, your freshman year you come in and you're like this, all the things you can take. And then each year you're in school, you're funneled towards your major and your contact with other students becomes narrower and narrower to just the kids, all the students who are in your major and your program. So it's fun to see somebody who's in art history talking to somebody who's in zoology about this thing they found. And they're two students who probably would never have a conversation in another context because they wouldn't be in a credit course together. So I think it's a really great way to bring interdisciplinary thinking about what we're finding there. And then the whole idea of what do we find? So related, not related, we have a student who pulled a travel journal from 1895 to 1900 for William H. Himbry. And William H. Himbry worked for the Electronic Telegraph Company. He was born in the countryside of England, got a job with the Electric Telegraph Company, gets sent to Africa to work on the telegraph because of their colonial holdings. They had a diamond mine or gold mine. And they had telegraphs built starting in 1880 to connect all the mines for communication. So she pulls it as a diary, and she's reading it, and we start to have a conversation about why is this guy from England in Africa? What's he doing? Oh, he's there for telegraph company. There's mining. Why is there mining? Oh, colonialism. Oh, well, who knows about that? Oh, I took an African studies class. And in my African studies class, I learned about this over here. And then it's, why are the pages tight? How did they get tight? Who collected this? Who printed it? So these questions with students bringing in all of the different topics they've talked about, things that they've studied, all on the basis of one book that she pulled out of the archive. And it became a conversation between a whole team.
And a team of students who are all trying to operate at a very high level. They are operating, trying to operate
at
a high level. And they have lots of questions, you know, and they I don't know if you have any, surely you remember college, right? You wanted to know it all, right? You wanted to figure it all out, and the passion they bring to it, and then you know our last group one was a climbing guide, so they'll go climbing together, and I don't know what we'll do with this group, but they start to get to know each other. That was something we didn't expect.
Yeah.
Was how having a cross-disciplinary group, we weren't really thinking of it in this way, that cross-disciplinary conversation group is really modeling the kind of collaborations we'd like to be seeing among the adult, not the adult, but because the professors and across the university.
Any other questions? If not, before we go, I'd like to show you something. This is a little bit of serendipity. I gave a talk yesterday for some of you who were here.
I wondered what that was.
It's called Extra Spot, and it's about old maps of the university, and I gave it to Bethel Lutheran Church yesterday. And at the end of the talk, a gentleman by the name of Don Cook and his wife Doris Cook came up and said, "Tom, would you like this?"
Oh my goodness.
And let me put it over here. This is a University of Wisconsin photo book from about 1920. Doris's mom was Dorothy West. And the cool thing about this for me was the handwritten in ink marginal notes. Here, beer men would be sadly out of place. And this is a picture of the home. But over here she says, "Where I spent many an hour of anxious labor, pies and cakes." So I thought it was really lucky that yesterday I got something like this. It's a little worm-eaten, but it's got provenance, and it's also very delicate. This is basically just corrugated cardboard. I sent an email to the archives today saying, "This is what I got. We have 50 similar to this, but we don't have the provenance. We don't have the marginal notes, and we don't have a living daughter living here in Madison." And so I thought for the whole idea of today, what you guys are doing, because your question was, what's going to be, are you the person who asked what's going to be cool? And sometimes it's going to be comic books or baseball cards or stuff like this. Because it's ephemeral, it's fading away, and yet we can digitize it and have the real thing, but also have the digital. I was just really lucky at the generosity of the folks yesterday that they were able to send this on to me, and now I can send it over to the 30 Mile Point Archive.
And that's exactly the kind of thing that happens in special collections, where somebody will say, "Hey, I've got this thing. Do you think it's interesting?" And they walk in with something that's beautiful.
Yeah.
This kind of story.
And you kind of go, "No, not really."
No one else will want it. No.
Yeah.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Any other questions? If not, thank you very much.